What, according to you, is a smart city for a common man?
I think almost 30-40% of our citizens in various, I think, parts of the country or cities live in slums. And they lack basic infrastructure. They even lack access to what we're calling about this ICT and other technology. It's not that they don't need it. They need it as well. So I think while we're talking about covering our smart cities, I would say that the larger need is to bring equity to these areas. And we're talking about 30-40% of the population living in kind of, you know, depressed areas, especially slums. So I think equity on water, and you should use smart technology for that as well, for distribution of water, cleaning up the streets. For that matter, many slums don't have sewerage systems to connect them. They're using septic tanks which are overflowing, and they litter up the streets and the environment. So I think this approach to smart cities is more needed for the slums as compared to, I think, the areas which are already better off.
Could you please elaborate the non-infrastructure part in a smart city?
Let's say that the smart solutions or smart technology is not an end itself. Ultimately, we're talking about people getting to use facilities. There's nothing wrong with that. If I start from my home, I know what time my train is going to come, how much space is available in that, what time my bus is going to come. I'll take that time to walk to my bus stand and actually use it. And also it can be used for, you know, managing traffic. So you get, like these days, Google gives you an information on your mobile, you know, to change your routes, you get an idea about it. So in a way that I think technology is not elitist, but it may be used in an elitist manner, which is a problem, I think. Huh? So it should be used in an equitable manner. And very often people say that, you know, to turn our infrastructure or physical infrastructure into smart, it may not cost more than 5-10% of the capital cost that is needed for, you know, laying roads and so on and so. So I think it is a positive move and maybe an opportunity to improve our cities. So it should be utilized.
Major portion of the investment is expected from the private sector. Do you think private sector will meet the expectations?
Private sector works like any other profit-making organization. They will see wherever they find that projects are profitable, and I think this is a big issue in cities, that a lot of projects which have social objectives, they get marginalized. And I think there is a kind of a need to kind of bundle projects which have social objectives and profit making projects. They need to be bundled together where we can actually, you know, bring a sense of parity in a, you know, city infrastructure development.
We in India lack open spaces for public in our cities. How do you see the importance of open spaces in a smart city?
When we talk about cities, actually cities are not made of buildings. Successful cities are made of public areas. You go to Bombay, you know, any person who doesn't want to spend a pie can spend a relaxed time on Marine Drive. Somebody who's not very rich can still go to India Gate. So I think it's important that we have a good quality public space system and people are able to reach there. But unfortunately, you know, many cities, especially in their new areas, they don't talk about these things. Many of these popular public spaces are in the old city areas, but they are messed. You know, people park wherever they want to park, and as I was saying in my talk, that our old cities or traditional cities are not geared for car-away society. So I think we need to put some kind of and our bazaars can be fantastic spaces. If you go to Europe, all their streets are pedestrianized. They're fantastic places for business and walking around. And walking is a healthy activity in a city. And so I see, and India is a culture of public spaces and streets, actually. And I think we need to recapture it.
How do you plan to make people smarter for the smart city?
No, I think it's primarily access to information and using it for decision making. And there is no reason why somebody who's doing a scooter job or running a taxi why can't he have a smart meter? In fact, somebody gave an example. In fact, the Prime Minister only gave an example how mobile phone has revolutionized the taxi business in the countryside. So I think access to technology and information is empowering people.
Yeah.
So I think it's a very important phenomena, and I think use of ICT and all that is something which will, I think, bring more, I won't say smartness, but more livability, improved quality of life.
The government has come up with the first list of smart cities. How do you see these 20 cities becoming smart in the coming years?
I think if you look at the current state of our cities, if you compare them with, say, any counterparts in, say, Europe or in America, it's going to take time to achieve that level of, I think, smartness. But however, I think beginning can be made through these. They have identified, say, retrofitting areas or area-based development under this mission. There's a possibility these can become as a pilot projects. And if these pilot projects are well implemented, and I'm sure other parts of the cities can also follow up that. But to me, I think to make cities more livable, smarter or whatever, I think our local bodies, our municipal bodies have to become smarter. That's where the problem actually lies.